until you feel you have enough to start pushing your own products out as well. And I'll say it's not a good life being a game developer to larger publishers. You're barely basically staying alive as a game developer in that relationship. But what you are doing is building your competencies, right? And there's pattern after pattern of game companies that have done that, polished their skills, and then struck out on their own with their own IP once they actually had come up with a learning curve. And I think that, to me at least, is one of the things, combined with both the lower barrier of entry, so you didn't need that training to begin with, and the fact that there's a willingness for these types of collaborative relationships with established game companies, it was the way we at least got started. It's not to say that, and I'll take a little time to emphasize on the downsides, it's not to say that it doesn't come with some downsides, right? I mean, one of the things I would really emphasize is in that scenario, pay attention to the types of bets you're making, right? Because you are letting hand come out. Are you going to be the best company to build the earth-shattering 3D MMO that'll take 1 year, that'll take 20 people 1 year if you're lucky to pull together, which is what we did all of last year? Or should you be the company focused on 50 little games that, you know, five of which make it, you know, cover your overhead and now allow you to take bigger bets? So those are the types of strategic issues you should think through early on rather than, you know, making mistakes and then, you know, try and learn from them the way we have.
And just the last sort of kind of question before we open up the Q&A is, what is very near and dear to my heart is the biz dev person, the big D word, distribution. With all this competition for people's attention and time and games, how do you stand out from the crowd regardless of what platform you're on?
You know, I am very biased toward believing that you're on your own. If you put too much emphasis on spending time knocking on all the key publishing and distribution partners that are out there, you will ultimately be losing valuable time promoting, self-promoting your own product. And yes, the budget constraints and, you know, all the spends involved that can really hamper how you do that. But there are so many great ways to get the word out about your content, the messages that you can deliver via your friends' networks on Facebook or MySpace or any of the, you know, social environments that are out there can actually produce some interesting results, you know, grassroots distribution marketing. So, you know, it's not that expensive to actually get started that way, and it can be a very valuable learning process to get initial feedback that allows you to actually get your content tuned up and ready for the bigger presentations and some of the bigger companies.
One of the things that I would say, and, you know, maybe this is a huge surprise, but at the end of the day, you know, if you're in the game industry, you're making games, and it's all about the game. Unless you can mix and juggle, like, you know, it's a whole different category. If you're doing content, at the end of the day, it's all about the games. So, from my perspective, and what I've seen over the last 10 years, is that if you make a great game, people are going to find you. And, you know, if it comes down, at the end of the day, in the space to, you make a great game, somebody's going to tell somebody else and it's viral. Or, you know, if you've already got a little bit of distribution, you know, it's not huge, but, you know, people are going to find a way to get to your game, or VCs are going to find a way to knock on your door. So I would channel a lot of that energy into making great games, because you can make a, you know, a good game, but at the end of the day, you're going to be fighting for distribution. So I take your energy and channel that into trying to figure out how to make a great game.
And with that, I'll turn it over to the audience. If there's any audience questions, you can just stand up, and I think you've got some mics floating around. And if you're going to address them to specific panels, just please do so with a question.
Hi, my name is Saad Khan. I'm a CME panel. I have a general question for the entire panel. What's your take on educational games? And do you think there's a breakout opportunity in the education space around games?
Education games?
Yeah,
edutainment's been a hugely popular area that's also been mixed with youth-oriented gaming. The one nuance I would say to that is, Club Penguin created a zillion copycats, and they all pitch VC saying, we're going to make it educational, so parents will like it. The thing to get very, very careful on for education gaming, remember your target player is the child or the student, is if they don't think it's fun and actually addictive, they're not going to buy it. So as much as you tailor your pitch with a
parents like and kids also enjoy playing. It's just a really hard problem, and if you solve it, I think you make a lot of money. But I do think it's a really tough thing to get right.
Yeah, that's the thing about Penguin. The reason that we lost the copy is that they're playing on the surface. It looks so simple to say, I can build a better one that looks like that. But the truth is, they figured out what makes it